I'm so pleased that you could join us today for the chemistry of cooking the perfect risotto. Please note the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. You can use this to submit questions. A few polling questions will pop up on your screen during the session, so please participate. And just as an FYI, we are recording this presentation. Our presenter today is Daniele Ramella, an assistant professor of instruction in the Department of Chemistry. Dr. Ramella joined Temple in 2015 and runs the undergraduate general chemistry and organic chemistry programs. He works closely with undergraduates interested in conducting research. He is also involved in developing new ways to incorporate collaborative problem solving and creative work ideas into the classroom. Daniele grew up in the town of Lodi in the Lombardy section of Italy. He learned to cook mostly from his grandparents, and through trial and error is now an accomplished home cook. He describes himself as a grandma cooking the traditional recipes from Northern Italy. Daniele, are you ready to begin?
Hello, good evening. My name is Daniele Ramella. As Kathy said, I'm from Northern Italy. I have a couple of pictures to show you exactly where from. Before we get started, I just would like to ask you, if you have questions at any time, please participate, type them up in a question and answer. I will try to address them just in voice because I will be doing things, so I will just answer by voice, but type up all the questions you wish to ask, and I will answer them. If you type in the chat instead, I may not see everything, so please keep it to the question and answer window. So we'll get started. Also, there are two windows, there are two cameras. You will have to kind of follow me between the two boxes. So here on Zoom, one will at some point be directed to the pot, and the other one will be directed to me. We will get started, and here is a better idea of where I come from. The town itself is called Lodi, as Kathy said. It's right here, close in this small triangle with Milano and Pavia. Milano is a famous city in Italy. Pavia instead is a smaller city, but it's also where I went to college. It's my alma mater is the University of Pavia, and Pavia is also Italy's capital of rice production, so it is pertinent to this. Specifically, this area between Pavia, Casale Monferrato, Alessandro, that area is the area where we produce the vast majority of the rice, and it's some specific qualities of rice. And I don't want to talk too much before I get started. I will start by showing you a few pictures. I gotta go back to this computer. I'll start showing you a few questions, a few pictures, and while I show you pictures where I am from, I'd like you to answer some of these questions, so I better get a feel if people actually know what I'm talking about, or I need to show you completely where we're from. Okay, I do see it's more than half, it's about half, a little bit more than half of you was in Italy. Give you another couple of seconds to answer, and then I'll close it. Normally with my class, I have this like 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, bloom, bloom, bloom. And then my class just goes nuts with this bloom, bloom, bloom weird sound that I make. So yeah, about half of you. Now, follow-up question. I asked you if you have been in Italy, but have you actually been in Italy? I love this live polling with all the bars that go up and down. Okay, why am I bringing this up? The reason I ask this follow-up question is because a lot of people say, well, I've been to Italy. I went to Milan, I went to Rome, Florence, and Venice, which of course are in Italy, but they're not exactly where you will encounter the real life of the country, right? They're mostly touristic spots. There are a lot of smaller cities, smaller towns, like, I'm going to close this polling up. Smaller towns like the one I come from. My hometown, you can see pictures, is mostly medieval in what you can see right now. Actually was founded before the Roman Empire. There are some old writings from before, I think it was a cousin to Cicero. It was like mentioned that he visited a small town in what was known as the Cisa Alpine Gallia, the Gallia on this side of the Alps. And there is a lot of, there is a very, very little left from the ancient Roman days, but most of it is medieval. It is a small town of 45,000 people. It is the main town of a province, and it does have this very ugly building, which is being celebrated a lot these days. It is the public hospital of my hometown. My hometown of Lodi also happens to be the main town of the province of Lodi, where the main and first outbreak of COVID-19 happened in Italy, and that has been, that hospital has been working, I'm going to say 25/8, more than 24/7, to keep everybody healthy. And they've done an outstanding job. Now you show up to the ER right now, they immediately know where to put it, they move you to a different hospital, and they've been working extremely well. So I just wanted to give them a shout out, since this has been really the epicenter of the outbreak. Next town I'm going to show you is the big city of Milan. Milan, at the picture top left, is it's fairly typical because we do have a lot of fog. It's a very humid area. And I'm going to go give you a question about Milan and see if you actually know anything, since there is more than half of you actually have been in Italy or thinks that they've been in real Italy, and see if you can answer this question. This is a little harder than, have you been in Italy? That's interesting. I'll start peeling the onion while you answer. Good, disagreement. Now, usually with my students at this point, I just tell them, okay, make a friend, look right, look left, make friends with your neighbors, and convince your neighbors you're right. You cannot do that, of course, because you're not in the same room, but I am glad to see that you finally settled, although with a narrow majority. Ah, no, you moved away. There was a narrow majority for the correct answer. It is where Leonardo painted the Last Supper. That is the right answer. The Last Supper, thank you for people who are changing their answer and going there now. Dante Alighieri is from Florence instead, and the region of Piedmont, the main city of Piedmont, is Turin, and the largest city in Italy is Rome, it's not Milan. Milan is the second largest. Okay, it is the heart of the financial, the fashion, probably also the nightlife. It is the most dynamic, young, there's a lot of research, colleges, etc. in Milan, but it is not the main capital, which is that as well. I am going to show you pictures instead of Pavia, which is where I went to college. And this is the town of the University of Pavia, which is the third most ancient university still operational, the first one being in Bologna, also in Italy, and the second one, it's either Cambridge or Oxford, at least so they claim. We are in the Middle Ages, and among the long list of professors who have taught in Pavia, there's also this guy. I don't know if you can recognize who that guy is, but he is Alexander Volta, or Alessandro Volta, would be the Italian name for him. So, here's another poll. Let's see if, since we're talking science, or somewhat science, let's see if you know what Alessandro Volta invented.
Go to the next poll, launch poll, go.
If you want, just let me know.
Okay.
All right, yes, I do like this majority. I'm going to end the poll because I do like this majority. The battery is the correct answer, electrochemistry. The radio was invented by another Italian, Guglielmo Marconi, and I actually have a grand aunt, or I had, she passed away several years ago, a grand aunt who worked as the nanny for the grandchildren of Guglielmo Marconi in Rome during World War II. But Alessandro Volta indeed invented the battery, or discovered that if you pile together copper zinc, you will build a battery. All right, enough of pictures. Let's start cooking. Olive oil, that's what I put in there. Oils are fat, and we know that. And everybody thinks that fat is bad. Fat is not bad. Fat indeed is most of the flavor that we taste. And there is nothing wrong with fat as long as, well, then you burn it off. The big issue and the reason that in the collective idea fat is bad is because it tends to be piled up. Sorry, I'm thirsty, I need wine. It tends to pile up in your body. Fat is what your body stores for when you run out of sugar. Sugars get you energy to keep going. You run out of sugar, you don't have anything else to burn, you couldn't eat that day, your body is going to start using something else once it runs out of sugars. In our society where we do eat every day, three times a day, sometimes even more than three times a day, or we snack all day long, we don't need to store all that fat, and that's why our body keeps piling it up. And that's how we get fat, and that is unhealthy because we have all these excess calories that we are not going to use. There is a vast array of fats, and olive oil is a specific one and tends to be a good one because it does have a lot of flavors. And here are some of the terpenes or sesquiterpenes or diterpenes that give flavor to oil. You can also see the composition of the main fats that you have in oil. Of course, it's not like it's called oleic acid. It comes from oleum, which is the Latin word for oil. It is the major component of olive oil. Now, you probably have heard about saturated, unsaturated, cis, trans, etc. The unsaturated word, for those of you who are not chemists or scientists, means that somewhere you have a double bond, right? And you see that it can be one, it can be multiple. And you can see that you can have a double bond where the two side chains are on the same side, or you can have a double bond where, let me find one. I don't have one here. I did have somewhere. I don't see one. You can have a double bond where instead the two side chains are on opposite sides. Where the side chains are on opposite sides, those are the ones who are called trans fats. And they tend to be not particularly healthy for human life. This is just a general chart which is going to give you an idea of some of the common fats. And the omega, you might have heard, is omega-3, omega-6, omega-9, omega-10. The omega label just really tells you where the, oh, here is a trans fat. That one is trans, right? The two side chains are pointing in opposite directions. The omega number, it's telling you in which position, if you start counting carbons 1, 2, 3, that's an omega 3. This would be carbon 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, etc. So that's what that omega number for fats really means. Before I show you the next slide, I have another question and see if you can guess that one. It's one about olive oil. Ready? And then I promise I'll start cooking. I think it's hot enough. I'll finish peeling the onion while you answer. Of course, I'm talking about cis and trans, so you immediately go to like, oh, it could taste no trans fats. Also because I think that the publicity and then the news and social media have hammered about this, like,
how bad trans fats are, so you're just gonna guess that that is the main reason. Everybody answered, the vast majority of people answered, okay, I'm gonna give you the answer. The correct answer is all of them. It does not contain cholesterol. Cholesterol is actually an animal hormone, and as such, is not containing olive oil that comes from olives, which are vegetables. And it has a low percentage of saturated fats. I had another chart for you over there. It does have a low percentage of saturated fats, which are harder to digest. And it does have a low percentage of polyunsaturated fats, which instead tend to just like sit there. Think about really the most liquid a grease or a fat, the more unsaturated it is, or more trans it is. So let's start cooking. Olive oil. Put it in a pan. And I'm gonna close the movie over there. Someone is actually, what are the ingredients? What should we do? First step, take some olive oil, put it in a pan. You can use a pan or a pot, either way it's gonna work. And then you're gonna heat it up. Now the bad thing about olive oil, it's not good for everything. The bad thing about olive oil is that it does have a fairly low decomposition point, meaning that it's going to decompose at relatively low temperatures. So if you're thinking about deep frying things, do not use olive oil, okay? Use canola oil, use vegetables oil, use sunflower, anything else, but do not use olive oil because it's going to decompose and do bad things in the pan and then give you chemicals which are not very healthy to eat. So that is the first step. The second step is onions. Onions, I did have another poll about this because not everybody reacts this similarly to onions. So second step, Arthur, who was asking a question, the second step is chop onions. And I was actually doing that while I was chit-chatting with you. I don't know if you can see that, onions are right here. I do actually cry a lot when I chop onions. I am not right now because I have all windows open. It's a very hot day. And how does that help? Mistakenly, people think that you can protect yourself from crying in front of onions by wearing goggles or protecting your eyes or keeping your face away from where you're chopping. That none of that works because it's a gas. It's a gas that's going to fly around and it's going to hit you. Really, the chemical reaction is drawn there on the left. What is happening there is that when you, yeah, majority of you cries when they chop onions. When you chop onions, the lacrimatory factor synthase, which is an enzyme, is released into the air. I'm gonna start cooking in the meanwhile. I'm gonna dump the chopped onions in the pan. Now, since I am starting to cook, I will turn this camera down. I think you can see inside my pan right now. Yep, pretty much. There it is. Okay. So I was saying this enzyme is released into the air by the onion. And this enzyme, do we have a question somewhere? This enzyme, through the window. In Florida, they say, is it true that manner by which you chop an onion will reduce the crying? The only way you get to not cry at all, and I don't know, there are a lot of myths and a lot of stories about how to chop an onion without crying. The correct answer is that the only way that always works is just make sure you are in a well-ventilated place. The reaction there on the left shows you that this gas is released, the propane thiol oxide after all of this. That's not what I meant to do. This gas over here, that is actually what makes you cry, and it's a gas. So the only way you avoid crying in front of chopping onions, you either chop them in a like outdoor, or you do it with all windows open, where there is a lot of ventilation, so that when you chop the onion, this gas is released, but it just goes away, it gets diluted by the wind outside the window, and you don't start crying. So that is the first step. You chop onion, and then you gotta add something else, of course, and we're gonna add our rice.
And here I have a few stories, but let me first put the rice in there. I have enough rice in this word, so I'm gonna use the second one as well. Let me just do this, and then once it starts cooking. I'm going to, how many onions? Well, it depends, of course, for how many people you're cooking. I'm making rice probably 4 or 5 servings, this is, and I use half an onion. This is the size of the onion I'm using, and I use half of it. Okay, it shouldn't be very heavy. Honestly, if you want something which is a little lighter in flavor, I would, Evelyn, I'll definitely come to your question. I have a few slides about that. If you want something which is a little lighter in flavor, lighter than onions, I would use green onions. They actually are my favorite. They also make you cry less, so that's good. Grace, I have several slides about rice and definitely not pre-cooked rice. This is raw rice, and I'm actually toasting it. It's just toasting in olive oil together with the onions. First, we made a sofrito, which is just the onion in there with the rice, and I am going to there, okay? So, this is an actual chemical reaction. It's called the Maillard, the name of the French scientist who figured it out. And of course, I'm an organic chemist, so I enjoy, I'm actually not as important as Kathy maybe. I do not run the general and organic chemistry programs. I just teach general and organic chemistry classes. I do run the undergraduate research in chemistry program instead. But I am an organic chemist by training, and I just love having all these reactions and all these molecules around. And I think that you can see that this reaction produces as the very last product acrylamide. I think that the word acryl or acrylic should ring a bell. That is very sour. Actually comes from Latin, acris, which means sour in Latin. That's why the wind turned off my flame. It comes from Latin acris, which is which means sour. And I know if you want like cooking tips, it's not it's not pretty good. How much rice? 3 people. I'm gonna say 0.5 pound per person, but that's because I eat a lot. I do. It really depends how much you're gonna cook. Am I gonna add the mushrooms after? The answer is yes. And I actually am going to do it right now. Here are the mushrooms. I already chopped them because, you know, time is never enough. So I'm adding the mushrooms after the rice for a specific reason. I do want the rice to toast first. It's the order of rice versus mushroom, sausage, whatever else you might be cooking. The order really depends on whether you have something that makes water or not. So if you have something like vegetables, I love a spinach risotto really, but spinach make a lot of water. And the reason I added rice before the mushroom is because I want the rice to toast in the oil first, and now I'm gonna add the wine. It's gonna start cooking. But what I was saying is that you don't want to put watery things like vegetables like spinach, even the mushroom. This one's actually didn't have much water, didn't make much water. But everything which could produce water, you're gonna add it after the rice. If instead you have something like sausage or other meat that does not make a lot of water, you want to put to add those before the rice because they need to cook a little more. So that is about the order of ingredients. Can you use red wine? You can, but only for very few specific types of risotto. It's always white wine otherwise. And only if you have something like, I'll use red wine only if I'm doing sausage and beans. But it needs to be something extremely earthy, right? Most things are not
earthy enough to take red wine. A red wine is just going to kill the flavor and overcome all other flavors. All right, so I think I answered your... Arborio is the right answer, yes. Arborio or Carnaroli are the two qualities that you can use. Arborio is definitely the best, and this was indeed Arborio rice, I tore the other label. Yes, Arborio rice is the one I do prefer for risotto above everything else. More wine, because there's never enough wine in this world. All right, so this one is gonna go there.
You're gonna watch it there. Oh, I was talking about acrylamide. Acrylamide is this sour
molecule, which is unfortunately carcinogenic, but it is so delicious. And I do have a question for you about that. While the rice starts cooking, we can chat a little bit more. Let's see if you can answer this question about...
Yeah, I think you got it.
Yes.
I think you got it. It is grilling, yes, totally. It's delicious. The charred is delicious. And it all comes from the Maillard reaction, which is this reaction between asparagine, which is an amino acid that is present in pretty much everything, but definitely a lot of it in meat, and a bicarbonyl, which is one of the products of the
They will react and will follow through all those steps, and then you're gonna eventually get to amino acid. You also see in the very last step, you have a molecule of ammonia being thrown out. If you don't do meat, and I think that it's rare to smell ammonia when cooking meat, you definitely smell ammonia when cooking fish. If you don't do it properly, you might have too much ammonia, and that makes your fish not good. I actually have a sad story. I grilled some shark the other night, and apparently it wasn't the freshest. And I, being a chemist, I spent way too many years in a chemistry lab, and I worked with organic sulfides for a while. So I don't really smell much. I taste much better than I smell as one of the senses in my body. So I couldn't really smell the ammonia too much, also because I was grilling outdoor. And then I put it on the table, and my wife was like, "This really smells like ammonia." So, and it really was gone bad, and we couldn't eat. So it was a sad moment. Three nice shark steaks, and we had to throw them out because of ammonia. But it is a decomposition product, and it comes from there. Okay, so here is another slide about the Maillard reaction, which is mostly telling you that pretty much everything, meat, rice, vegetables, pretty much everything can undergo the Maillard reaction, because pretty much everything has amino acids, which are present in proteins, and sugars instead, which are present in carbohydrates. Okay, so you worked on the rice, and you could see it toasted a little bit, and of course I'm not going to let it go too much, because rice, after it toasts a little bit, is just going to burn, which is not what you want, of course. And you work on the mushroom and everything else. Okay, sorry, that's the noise of the video. When we teach organic chemistry, we always have this thing about... separation funnels. It's a common technique where you separate organic from inorganic layers. And what you never want to do is to put alcohol in there. Why? Because alcohol is soluble in both the organic layer and the water layer. So it's going to make an emulsion between fats and water, and you're not going to be able to separate them anymore. And of course, in an organic chemistry lab, you do want to separate them. In a kitchen instead, and mostly when making a risotto, what you want to do is to be able to do that, is to be able to make an emulsion. And you can maybe see it started to get together, it started to get creamy. Emulsion between water and the fats is what really makes risotto very creamy. And the secret is the wine. This side, I don't want to make any advertisement for any specific wine right now.
But you want a white wine, you want it to be dry, you don't want it sweet, because otherwise the risotto is going to taste sweet, and of course the risotto is savory, it's not sweet. And while it's saying savory, that reminds me, we need salt.
It's not going to taste like anything if you don't add some salt.
Rice is full of starch, so it's going to sponge out quite a bit of salt. But if you oversalt a risotto, it's really gross. And God, I made a lot of oversalted risottos when I was a teenager. You know, parents both worked, and I grew up with my grandparents. I mostly learned from them how to cook, but then my grandparents died, and my brother is much younger than I am, so there I am at home cooking for myself and for my brother, and my parents are gone, and there was a lot of trial and error in that, and I made some risottos which were salty, you really couldn't eat them anymore. Okay, so I was talking about emulsion, and you saw I put water and I put wine and I put the alcohol from wine, and I will keep adding water specifically as broth, and then I'm gonna get there.
But we need more fat, and the fat you want in that in there is butter. So if someone ever tries to sell you a vegan risotto, they're lying. Okay, you can try with some margarines, but God, they do not taste good. Okay, a vegan risotto does have an issue. There's plenty of vegetarian risottos, of course.
I'm gonna put the butter in the fridge because it's really melting here.
There's plenty of vegetarian risottos, of course. Mushroom risotto is vegetarian itself. I started with mushroom because I was doing it for my class. I was like, I don't know if someone is vegetarian, so I'm gonna do it vegetarian for everybody. But vegan is pretty much impossible. You do need a good chunk of butter to make it emulsionate the right way. You will not be able to make it as creamy because emulsion is going to break if you try to put olive oil. Olive oil is fine for the sofrito at the beginning, but butter is much better. And the reason is that the butter does contain water itself, so it is already something that will be able to mix together. The fats in butter can mix together with the water, and the alcohol wine actually helps blending them together. Okay, let's get to rice. Now, if there are Asian people in the audience, or maybe even Latinos or South American, they're probably gonna scream at this. Many cultures use rice, but you do not wash your rice when you make a risotto, ever. The quality of rice, and I might have a slide about that, no, I don't. The quality of rice about that, the arborio, the carnaroli, is crucial because those are rices which are very high in starch. Amylopectin and amylase are polymers, and their amylopectin is mostly what forms starch. Starch is just a common word for it. Amylopectin is a little more nerdy because we want to be scientists. You don't ever wash rice when you're trying to make a risotto. The reason is that you do need that starch. Starch is not water soluble, but it will partially fall apart when during the cooking, which is the same reason you can caramelize onions, and et cetera, et cetera. It falls apart partially while cooking, so you do get all this natural creaminess added to it. I mean, of course, you could get the same thing adding 5 sticks of butter and 3 bottles of wine. That wouldn't be the healthiest option. Starch instead is healthier because most of it is not even digested. It just comes in and goes out. It just goes through. But it does add to that starchiness. If instead you're just trying to boil rice to serve a side. I see a question popping up. What was the liquid you just added? Yes, I'll get there. It's broth. It's a broth, I'll get there in a moment. What was I saying? Yes. Oh, if instead you want to make like a white rice to serve on a side, very common in Asian cuisine or in Caribbean cuisine, that's why they do wash their rice. If you want to do that, you wash the rice because you need to wash away that starch. Otherwise, you just get blue. If you just try to boil long grain white rice as you buy it from a supermarket, and you know the one that you use to serve on a side with some meat and gravy, that one needs to be washed. Otherwise, you'll just get glue out of it. It's just going to come together and just not the best. Instead, to make risotto, you do want to save the starch because it's going to participate in making the creaminess. So I promise I will get to the broth. I do have a couple of slides about that as well. And yes, I'll get there. Water. Northern Italy is water. It's water all over the place. Growing up, I never had to fear an earthquake. I never had to fear hurricanes. I never had to fear anything, any natural disaster except for flooding. Flooding is very common. And the picture you have in front of you actually is not a river, is not a lake, it's a water canal. They are artificial canals. The entire northern Italy has a lot of water, and there are big rivers, but what they have done over the centuries, they build canals between every single field where we cultivate things, and there's all this level of water going up and down, and all the closing system, and all the dam, all a dam system, you can open and close and all the water goes in and out. Where does that water come? That comes from glaciers. We have a lot of glaciers up on the Alps. I grew up in this city next to Lodi, which is not, and I'm going to open the next poll while I talk. Oh, I skipped one. I'll go back to that one later. We have a lot of glaciers. I grew up hiking on glaciers, and I just love them. I would live on a glacier. Next time the person who ran out a webinar today, next time you need to go to Antarctica, please bring me with you. I just love ice. I'm dying. It's like 80 degrees barely, and I'm already. So yes, bring me to ice. I love ice. So. Now we have five people who have been on a glacier. Okay, so it's quite an experience. You really are at the top of the world. You look down on everything, and you realize that you're in a place where nobody survived up there, and it's great. The big problem is that those are all pictures. Unless there is a link somewhere, these are all pictures I have taken myself, including the ugly selfie of my ugly face. Apologies about that. That actually isn't a glacier. That's just a small pile of snow there. The very sad thing is that I've been hiking those mountains since I was a child in the 80s, and I can tell you, I might have a better picture to show that. Yes, I'm telling you that if you know anything about orography, go back. This level, you see where the slope is that here it becomes very steep as a slope, but up here, this one was carved by the river going down. Up here, this was all a glacier. And I was saying, this really kills me. Every time I go up the Alps right now and I look up and I take pictures, in 30 years, we lost about a third of the alpine ice. And that is, you know, global warming, of course. I'm talking about a global warming, climate change. That is heartbreaking. It's heart-wrenching. It's just like we are losing what has been there for millennia. What really shaped the mountains, what really shaped the landscape, is disappearing. And you really can see how in 70 years since the 50s, half of it is gone. But while we have it, we use all this water. And I have another question. Actually, before I move on, I forget to ask you a question, so stop this one. Oh, before we move on, before I ask you the questions about water and the abundance of water and what we use water for, here was a question about using wine. And, oh, I don't open it. So, here's a question. Italian doctors do recommend...
I'm just following doctor's orders here. Do recommend one glass of red wine, specifically red, per day, little less if you're pregnant, and please, I'm saying little less. I'm not saying no wine if you're pregnant. That is something I've never heard of until I came to the United States, that pregnant women cannot drink wine. Pretty sure my mother drank wine while she was pregnant.
And just to save you the pain of typing up the joke, yes, this is the result. Let's see. Let's see if we can see if there is a majority. There seems to be a majority on there seems to be a consensus. Yes, I do agree. A is the correct answer. It does contain antioxidants. They're mostly related to the tannins, and that is why it's red wine specifically and not white wine. But it is true. The second one, alcohol in the blood flow will help wash away cholesterol. That's a legend. That's something we say all the time, just as a joke. It's not true, right? The big issue with cholesterol is that it is liposoluble. It dissolves in fat. It doesn't dissolve in water. So once it gets in our blood, and it really doesn't dissolve well in alcohol either. Once it gets in our blood, which is all water-based, you don't have much fat in your blood. The fat is in the fat tissues. Once it gets in there, it just precipitates, it crashes out, solubility decreases, it crashes out, and it will just close your veins. Whether they also do it as an excuse to drink themselves, I've always believed that. It's probably true. I'm actually surprised nobody answered that it lowers the level of stress, because it totally does. And you just get much happier when you drink one. Okay. I'll move on. I'll go back to I have to go back to water. I'm sure people prefer wine. Chef Zoe wants to know, I guess Zoe is Arthur's wife, I'm gonna guess, what level of heat you're cooking at? Pretty high, pretty high. Let's see if I can just go back to, it's hard to, yeah, go back to, you can, you cannot see the flame, there's way too much light in here, but I don't know if you can see the flame. It's a big flame. It's a pretty high level of heat. That's why I keep stirring. Okay, so water matters. You can see in those pictures in the slides, I think it's to my left, launch bowling there. You can see in the picture over there that those fields are flooded, and those are man-made water meadows. We just flood the fields, and it's an historical thing that northern Italians would do. Like, we have so much water that why not? And let's see if you can figure out why. Ha! Getcha! I finally get to say getcha. No, it is not to prevent flooding, because this actually happens in winter when most of the water on the mountains is frozen as snow or ice, so it's not coming down rivers. The correct answer is to prevent the dress from freezing. You just raise the level of water in one kennel at one end of the field, and you lower the level of water on the opposite end of the field, and water is going to flood the field, go through, and go down in the kennel on the other side. Water, as long as it's moving, gotta be liquid. And if water is liquid, it's above freezing point. If it is above freezing point, look at the pictures. There is snow everywhere, there is ice everywhere, but where the field is flooded into a meadow, look at that. Grass is green. You can get grass in January, February, and through the entire winter to feed the animals in the farm, because grass will keep growing, because, yeah, I'm gonna freeze. You're keeping it liquid on purpose. Haha, I gotcha, at least on one of them. Okay, next one, it's finally about rice. And these instead are the rice paddles that we have pretty much everywhere in that area between Pavia and Alessandra that I showed you on the map at the very beginning. I need more broth. I think it's almost done. It's probably time to start tasting it. I hear a whisper from behind me who says, "Did someone say taste it?" I think my boyfriend wants to come in with a fork and taste and see if it is almost ready. Yes, we do have a good answer here. It is due to the sensibility to temperature. The rice plant is very sensitive to temperature changes, and if you flood it and you keep it underwater, it's going to, you can taste it so you can see how it is going. It's probably not ready yet, but just please taste for salt and readiness, please. He's in the house, he's the one who's just, he can put like boiling water in his mouth and it doesn't burn, so I make him taste things. So I am going to close this, go back to tasting, and I think I want to show you this. It is a video, it does have a volume and a song. I need to be quiet.
Bastone. Oh bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, 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 il capo in piedi col suo bastone, e noi curve a lavorare, e noi curve a lavorare, il capo in piedi col suo bastone, oh bella ciao, bella ciao, bella ciao, 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 il capo in piedi col suo bastone.
Me singing, but, and let me move on before we get to random videos. There. Ooh, there. So, wow, nice. A lot of people think this tune is familiar, and I think four people are like, yes, but in a completely different context. The correct answer is that this is an extremely famous song, O Bella Ciao, Bella Ciao, but it is mostly known because it was used by partisans while they were fighting the fascists between 1943 and 1945. That tune just had different lyrics. I don't expect many people here to speak Italian well enough to recognize the lyrics in the song, but it did have different lyrics, and it was mostly, I'm sort of going over time, but I promise it's almost ready, I'm almost done. The original song actually was about this very hard work that specifically women did in rice paddies. Someone was asking, how does it survive? How does it? Oh yes, it was in the movie Money Heist. Yes, that is true. That's how you probably know it. And someone was asking, how does it survive flooding? The reason is that you flood it gently, so it's not like a violent thing, and it's not quite flooding. You just put it underwater. It helps keeping the temperature constant, so the plant is not subject to temperature variations. And of course, within that big rice paddies, you also get a lot of weeds. And what those women were tasked with doing there in the video I just showed you was to spend the entire day bent down in the sun with their legs in water, pulling out plants of rice, transplanting them in nice lines, and pulling out weeds and throwing them away because you don't want the weeds to suffocate the rice. My grandmother did that job only a couple of years, and then she kind of gave up. My great-grandmother instead did that job for many years. It was specifically a women's job because men were mostly employed in the fields to do physically, I cannot say more demanding. They were jobs where you needed more strength. This instead was a job that needed a lot of resilience and the ability to stand pain longer, and women tend to be better than men at that. So women were definitely exploited. It did start as a song, as a song of women who were saying, well, we're gonna, you know, they were dreaming about the day they didn't have to do this anymore, and then they were thinking about unionizing, et cetera, et cetera. And they did have a very communist upbeat to it. I'm gonna go back here. And that is why then during the partisan war against fascists, someone wrote different lyrics and it was used during that time. Okay, broth. Someone was asking about broth. The broth, the liquid I've been adding throughout the entire cooking is broth. Beef stock is the best. It's very tasty. I normally when I make a stock for broth, it's a mix of a couple of chicken quarts and beef chunks. You really can use any meat. I'm gonna say, of course, you can use vegetable broth, but you can add meat to be very flavorful. Okay, it's almost ready. I'm just gonna add the very last ingredient, which is saffron. Saffron has a strong flavor that comes from safranol, the molecule at the top in that slice. You can see it, yes. And it also has a very clear, very strong color. As you see, and I don't know if there are Iranians in the audience or people from around that area, Iran is a long tradition of saffron. Italy does as well, but for other reasons. And I don't want to spoil the next question. But as you see, it was red when I added, and it turned yellow as cooking quite quickly. The reason it changes color is because that other molecule, the one at the bottom on the slide, is the color which is responsible for in that hyperconjugated or the long chain of double bonds. That is responsible for the red color. And when you cook it, you break it down, that gets decomposed. And so from the bright red color disappears, and you're just left with a little of yellow in there. Now, question polls. Yes, thank you. Yes, oh, Zoe was the daughter, and she is a chef. I am actually kind of ashamed now that I'm talking to someone who fathers a chef. Yes, thank you. Blah, blah, blah. Dismiss. Saffron. We don't have that. Yes. So saffron is actually extremely expensive. Per ounce is more expensive than gold. That tells you, like, it's very hard to get saffron. I did have, let's see if I still have any of it, or the fish. Some rough safflowers. Yes, here they are. They actually are sort of like, I don't know if you can see it. It's a nice white dust. This is rough, It's rough saffron. It still does the job because considerably less, but you need to use more of it, of course. Or you can use the very refined powder I just added in here. It gives the yellow color. That's where rice, yellow rice comes from. Most of the times is saffron. I gotta keep stirring because I think this is gonna be ready. Taster! I need someone else. I need someone to taste the rice again. Good. It didn't show up with a
big plate. Please taste a little bit and see it should be ready now. Can I? Yes. I'm gonna launch you another poll, another quiz, and then I promise we're done. Let's see if you can answer this question. How's it?
About ready? Okay. The rice is about ready, and I'm gonna let people go for dinner. I know I went a little over time. What can I do? I'm Italian, I talk too much. Okay, I know that at least one friend whose Indonesian heritage is in the audience. I do apologize if Indonesia is also trying to relaunch the production of saffron. Afghanistan is the correct answer. Afghanistan used to be a very wealthy country, and then the Soviets took it over, and then the Taliban took it over, and then the never-ending war happened. And right now, the way Afghans have to make a lot of money quickly is to grow poppy seeds and to sell opium out of it. But of course, opium is not very good for society because people, you know, get addicted to opium, which is not good. So the government is trying to convince Afghan to resume this long lost tradition of selling.
I'm actually gonna taste it myself now.
Of growing saffron because it can really be very profitable. And in Northern Italy has a tradition of using saffron because of Marco Polo. We are in the 11th century, and Marco Polo goes to China and comes back, but while coming back from China, also stops in places like Central Asia, like Afghanistan, and brings back, among all the Indian spices, also India uses a lot of saffron as well, of course. I'm not going to say that India doesn't have saffron, but it brings back saffron from Central Asia, and that's why we do use a lot of saffron. I win. It's good. Okay. I think we are... I'm going to stop this. I'm going to lower the flame because food is ready, and I am sorry,
to say that the food is ready. That was a process.
Because now I'm going to eat the whole thing, and you're not. I have one last question for you, and I see a couple of questions. I'll address them. You don't have... front ringer exactly what does my apron say? The apron, I don't know if you can. You can I? So I did this in my orgo class, orgo 2 class. It was actually funny because the in the curriculum of organic chemistry at the end there is lipids, carbohydrates, fats, fatty acids. Oh, I didn't launch the polling, sorry. Go. And so at the very end, I did this, but I actually showed up with my lobster pot and I cooked for 60 people, and students enjoyed it so much that they actually made me gift of this apron. Let's see if you did this camera's right better. You can see it says the chemistry is just like cooking, but don't make this food because, yeah, what we use in chemistry. That was a picture that some student took. Colleagues was like, why do your students like you that much? You are not a good teacher. And I'm like, I know I'm not a good teacher, but I cook them dinner, so they like me. Problem solved. Now you know why my SFF development forms are always great. Yes, please cook it yourself. You really like, I'm chatting with you and it took a little longer because I was talking with you, but otherwise 20 minutes, half an hour, I can really cook you a risotto for 100 people, and there is no reason whatsoever. There is no reason whatsoever to go spend $40 for a plate of risotto because rice is just a filler, and as such, it was a fairly cheap thing, and everybody knows it. Sina, yeah, you can buy safranal. It's an aldehyde. It's actually not hard to synthesize safranal, and I'm pretty sure you can go to the Sigma Aldrich website and just order. A bunch of, a kilogram of saffronal, but there is all those specific little things. It's like drinking pure ethanol instead of drinking alcohol which has been distilled from grapes. Doesn't have all those side aromas that come when you distill alcohol from grapes and you get grappa, which as an Italian I sometimes abuse. No, I'm not a drunk, don't worry. There is all those aromatic ethers, aromatic, not aromatic as in aromatic green, but aromatic as in they have an aroma, ethers that come along. And so is with the saffron from the flower, from the actual plant. So yes, you can make it. There is artificial saffron, and I wouldn't be surprised if some restaurants or some big chains were using artificial flavoring. And there's artificial flavoring from pretty much everything. You know, there's vanilla, there's vanillin. You can buy kilograms of vanillin for 30, 40 bucks from Sigma Aldrich. And we did have a big jar of vanillin in the lab when I was a graduate student. And it's I think I answered. When campus opens, can we get a taste? Yes, I would do this in person. I would actually be cooking for all of you if we were on campus. Take your time, Arthur, to finish cooking. I was saying, in grad school, we have this big jar of vanillin, I think it was vanillin, yes. And you know, it's grad school, you're a grad student, your life sucks because you're a grad student and it's supposed to suck. And your PI is being a word I cannot say in public because he's a professor, he's a university professor. I am one, so I can say that. And you had the bad days. And the best thing was go grab this big jar of vanillin, open. And it made life so much better. So yes, there is plenty of artificial flavors, but when you taste it, it is lacking and it's missing all the side aromas that really make it the aroma that you want. It's the same thing with freezing or using frozen ingredients. It's the same thing with using things which are not fresh. You lose all those side things. You still have the main flavor in there, but you lose all the side flavors and you really miss out on the experience. So I think I've talked way too much. I'm logorroic, I'm sorry. My students know that very well and they know they just mute me at some point. I will type up the recipe. Evelyn is asking. Evelyn, you know I'm gonna cook for you whenever we are allowed to be together again. You just bring the wine and we are gonna have dinner. But yes, I will type up the recipe and give it to Barb, and I'm pretty sure that Barbara will share it with everybody else. If you want my email address, just you can look up my profile. I'm a professor at Temple, so just Temple faculty. And it's just daniele.ramella@temple.edu. That's what it is. Let's see if I can. daniele.ramella@temple.edu. I'm done. I'm just filling in silence until either Barb or Kathy comes back and grabs.
I'm back, Daniele. Thank you so much for that informative and entertaining presentation. As Daniele said, we will follow up next week with not only the recipe, but I will include, he's eating, but I will also include Daniele's email at Temple. So if anyone would like to reach out to him personally. But thank you so much. I don't know about anybody else, but now I'm starving and I really think I need a glass of wine. So, but I also want to thank all of you for participating. We hope to plan some more Zoom activities in the future, but we really also look forward to be able to have some alumni and friend events back on campus. So stay connected with the College of Science and Technology. You can follow us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, but most importantly, we hope you have a great evening and a wonderful weekend, and we're so happy you could join us today. Thank you all. Thanks, Daniele, and everyone, have a great night.
Very last thing, it goes much better with Parmesan cheese grated on top.
Now I'm really hungry. Thanks so much.
Bye-bye.